3, 2, 1.
On November 18, 2023, Starship took one step closer to Mars.
We have liftoff.
One day, Elon Musk expects the most powerful rocket ever to carry 100 people to the red planet. Unlike the first test flight in April, this flight achieved a milestone. Starship fired its engines before detaching from the Super Heavy booster.
Stage separation.
Boost bank startup.
This complicated maneuver didn't happen previously, as a fuel leak led to a fire in the booster, damaging most of its 33 engines. Starship veered off course, and the team had to destroy it over water for safety reasons. And remember the damage to the launch pad last time? This time, SpaceX reinforced the launch pad with a steel plate cooled by 260,000 gallons of water. The plan was to lift off from Starbase in Boca Chica, Texas, with a booster splashing down close to shore while Starship soared before landing in the Pacific Ocean near Hawaii. However, as Elon is aware, not everything goes according to plans.
As you can see, the Super Heavy booster has just experienced a rapid, unscheduled disassembly.
The booster exploded in spectacular fashion after separating from Starship, which is believed to have self-destructed after the team lost contact with it 10 minutes in. SpaceX says the lessons learned from this flight will help improve Starship's reliability. After all, it took the Falcon 1 four tries before it reached orbit and saved the company from impending death. SpaceX even compiled a video showing all of its failed attempts to land its orbital boosters. If Mars were not the eventual target, Elon would not need such a large rocket that towers over the SLS and the Saturn V that took us to the moon.
It's more than twice the thrust of a Saturn V. That's the largest rocket ever to get to orbit.
He had already achieved remarkable success with the Falcon 9, which has become the world's most reliable rocket, regularly transporting crew and cargo to the ISS, a lucrative business. But wealth was never the end game, as Elon expressed in his biography written by Walter Isaacson. I could have made a lot of money, but I could not have made life multiplanetary. The Falcon 9 is not big enough or powerful enough to go all the way to Mars. Not even its larger sibling, the Falcon Heavy, can do that. The Falcons are also not fully reusable. While the first stage returns to Earth and the payload fairings are fished out of the sea, the second stage is not recovered. Starship is designed as a fully reusable rocket, essential for long-duration missions, a capability enhanced by its stainless steel construction, like the kind used on the Cybertruck. Elon fell in love with stainless steel a few years back, joking to his team, "Stainless steel and I should go get a room somewhere." Starship was originally supposed to be made out of carbon fiber. However, the carbon fiber sheets were expensive and not up to the job. Even the specialized expertise that went into them could not prevent issues like developing wrinkles. Elon knew that if they went the carbon fiber route, this extrapolates to death. "I'll never be able to get to Mars," he told Isaacson. So, inspired by the earliest Atlas rockets that took the first Americans to orbit, he opted for stainless steel. It was an odd move, according to his executive team, because stainless steel is heavier than carbon fiber. But Elon looked at the situation differently. The high melting point of stainless steel eliminated the need for as many heat shields to protect Starship as it re-enters the atmosphere, where temperatures can soar as high as 1,500 degrees Celsius or 2,700 degrees Fahrenheit. Fewer heat shields mean the overall weight is reduced. And stainless steel maintains its strength even when holding supercooled liquid oxygen and methane, which is used to fuel Starship. The first prototype of Starship was the Starhopper, which had retractable legs to test how it could land when it returns to Earth. However, Elon has since decided to try to catch Starship, both the ship and the booster, with a tower that holds the rocket on the launch pad. The SpaceX team was once again nervous at such a bold proposal. What happens if the catch fails and destroys the launch tower and the next flight is delayed? When someone on X asked why not just use the landing legs for the booster, Elon replied, "Legs would certainly work, but best part is no part. Best step is no step," highlighting his preference for reducing complexity to bring down costs and make space travel more affordable. He's applied the same principle to the design of the Raptor engines that power Starship. He wanted to lower the cost of a single engine prototype from $2 million to $200,000. This strategy worked for him in the past, when he wanted to buy refurbished ICBMs from Russia, but found the cost of $8 million for one too high, and decided to create his own company to build more affordable rockets. He's since coined the term idiot index, a metric comparing the cost of a component to the cost of its raw materials. Let's say the nozzle for the engine hypothetically costs $20,000, but the raw material cost is $2,000. So the ratio on Elon's idiot index would be 10 to 1. A high ratio suggests the production process for this component is more expensive than it really needs to be. When Elon asked financial analyst Lucas Hughes, "What are the best parts in Raptor as judged by the idiot index?" And Hughes responded, "I'm not sure." Elon reamed him out. As reported in Isaacson's book, he said, "You better be effing sure in the future you know these things off the top of your head. If you ever come into a meeting and do not know what are the idiot parts, then your resignation will be accepted immediately." Unbeknownst to Elon, the analyst had other things on his mind. He had just lost a newborn daughter a few weeks before. Elon had suffered a similar loss when his firstborn, Nevada Alexander, died of sudden infant death syndrome. When Isaacson later asked Elon if he felt he was being too harsh, Elon said, "I try to criticize the action, not the person. We all make mistakes. What matters is whether a person has a good feedback loop, can seek criticism from others, and can improve. Physics does not care about hurt feelings. It cares about whether you got the rocket right." The analyst was much more prepared the next day. He discovered that parts with the highest cost compared to raw material required a lot of high-precision machining. Elon decided that the person in charge of each component should try to get their costs down by 80%, and if they couldn't, they should step aside if someone else might be able to do so. "Elon has always operated with an extreme sense of urgency, as if every second counts," declaring, "We need to get to Mars before I die." He assigned the responsibility for revamping Raptor to a young engineer named Jacob McKenzie. The directive, in Musk's words, was to delete any part that is even potentially unnecessary. McKenzie consulted a Tesla executive to help streamline SpaceX's manufacturing, similar to how Tesla continues to streamline its process of mass-producing electric vehicles. The result is that version 2 of the Raptor engine removed many of the intricate plumbing components and looked much simpler.
You know, V1 looks like kind of like a Christmas tree spaghetti pile. A lot of fiddly bits. Raptor 2 costs about half as much as Raptor 1. Despite having much more thrust, it's only going to get better from here.
Elon's hands-on approach is embodied by his choice to live just a mile away from Starbase. Despite being the richest person in the world, he resides in a two-bedroom house where caffeine-free Diet Cokes are common, as are midnight meetings with the Starship team. Living and breathing the mission to make life multiplanetary. Building the most advanced rockets in the world would not be possible without the hard work of brilliant engineers. If you've been inspired by Elon and the team at SpaceX and want to brush up on your skills in math, computer science, and data science, I highly recommend Brilliant, a website and app where you can learn interactively. Whether you're aspiring to be part of the next generation of space explorers or you're simply looking to enhance your skills no matter your profession, Brilliant's interactive lessons can help you on your journey. I personally use Brilliant to improve my analytical thinking skills by going through their logic puzzles. There's something for everyone, whether you're just starting out or want to progress to more challenging puzzles. And if you get stuck, you can view the explanation to discover the correct approach. You can try out Brilliant for free for 30 days using my link in the description, brilliant.org/newsthink. If you're one of the first 200 people to sign up via my link, you'll get 20% off your premium subscription, unlocking all of Brilliant's courses. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.